So I just wanted to welcome everyone to this afternoon panel on flattening sensations, science, technology, and affect. Following the lead of others, I just want to say thanks to the organisers and all those involved for what's gone into this conference. I've not seen a delegates list, but I think I'm the only person here from the UK. I know many friends and colleagues, such as Jennifer Cook at Loughborough University, whose marvellous interview with Lauren Berlant in the most recent issue of Textual Practice, wanted to be here, as did many other sort of friends. I feel quite a pressure of taking notes from an entire country's academics while I'm here to dissimulate on my return, which is, of course, impossible with all of the rich material that's come out of the panels and all of the side conversations as well. Our effective encounters with science and technology can extend from the very banal, and I was thinking here of an anecdote in relation to Sean Scanlon's work this morning on what it feels, what globalisation feels like when I discovered that my electric shaver doesn't work here in America, hence the beard, through to profound encounters with the biomedical, the pharmacological, military, agricultural and communications, among many. I'm particularly looking forward to this panel and to think about some of the points they raise in relation to my own work on how it feels to be a vegan and an animal advocate for non-human animals, particularly in relation to animals as technologies and machines. And it's a real privilege to be here with such wonderful scholars in this room who, just so I have the opportunity to say, have affected scholarship in the UK very profoundly. And it's a privilege here to be with the four panellists who we're going to hear from now. I'm going to introduce them all together, which means I can then get out of the way and then they can come up and present. At the end of which, hopefully, we'll have some time for discussion. So first is Brenton Malin with a paper entitled The Path to the Machine, Affect Studies, Technology and the Problem of Emotion. Brent is from the Department of Communications at the University of Pittsburgh. His new book, Feeling Mediated, A History of Media Technology and Emotion in America, is just out with New York University Press, and he's doing a reading from the book at Prairie Light Bookstore at 2 p.m. on Sunday, if you want to get down there. Next is Maria F. Fackler, who is Associate Professor of English at Davidson College, where she also teaches courses in gender and sexuality studies. She has published work on the gossip and queer intimacies that circulate online on the figure of the fag hag, and the effective bonds and queer coalitions that fag-hag dynamics both unveil and embody, and on the figure of the artist Mank in works of Muriel Spark and Doris Lessing. Her paper is titled The Flatness Problems of the Digital Age. Patrick Grzanka is an Honours Fellow at Barrett, the Honours College and Affiliate Faculty of the Centre for Biology and Society at Arizona State University. In the fall, he will join the Department of Psychology at the University of Tennessee as an assistant professor in the counselling psychology program. His interdisciplinary work broadly explores the psychosocial dimensions of intersecting inequalities such as race, gender, and sexuality, with a particular focus on emotions and mental health. He's co-authored his paper with Joe Miles, who cannot unfortunately be here to present the talk, but Joe is an assistant professor of counselling psychology at the University of Tennessee. And to close the panel, we have Tim Yaczo. Tim is a PhD fellow at the Amsterdam School for Cultural Analysis, where his dissertation project, Brains with Character, investigates encounters amongst neuroscience, literature, and critical theory. His paper is Fears of Amygdalae from Iowa City, Neurons, Narrative, and Affect. So please welcome all the presenters, beginning with Brent. Thank you.
All right, thank you, and it's great to be here. And I actually did my PhD in communication here at the University of Iowa in Communication Studies, so it's great to be back in Iowa City. And my paper is going to have a little bit of an Iowa City focus actually too. So we'll be bookended by some Iowa City discussion. So my book, Feeling Mediated, isn't about affect theory per se, but today I wanted to think a little bit about how some of the analyses that I do in there, these historical analyses, what they might say to affect theory in particular. So some of the sections of this are very well formed and some are a little less so because these are new and a work in progress. So, and I'm interested in particular in parallels between the early 20th century, which is really the focus of the book, my book, although I draw some parallels to the contemporary moment between that and how emotion is thought about in that period by the people that I'm talking about, and then how we think about affect in much sort of affect scholarship. The interest in the book, one interest in the book and in general is the relationship between technology and emotion and how we think about technology impacts how we think about emotion. And so that's one of the focuses. And actually discussing the internet age, Alexander Galloway says, the net is nothing if not the grand parade of personality profiles, wants and needs, projected egos, second selves, and second lives, leading him to conclude that, quote, there seems to be more affect today than ever before. And this idea about this kind of connection between technology and affect, I want to say, has a very long history, even much longer than I'm even going to talk about. We could go back to Socrates and talking about writing, but I'm going to go back to the early 20th century and in the U.S. and in particular in Iowa City. So, and basically, my argument in a nutshell is this, that when you get what I want to call a neo-romantic conception of emotion and, which I'll talk about in a little bit more detail, and a rhetoric of the and a powerful rhetoric of the technological sublime, you are on, as I'm calling it, the path to the machine. And the machines here that I'm talking about are emotion measuring machines. In the period that I'm talking about, the early 20th century, the emotion measuring machine is something like a psychogalvanometer, and now it's something like an MRI or an fMRI. And so I want to kind of work through this by starting, and when I say this kind of neo-romantic idea of emotion, I want to start with a little section of a poem from William Wordsworth. From nature and her overflowing soul, I had received so much that all my thoughts were steeped in feeling. I was only then contented when with bliss ineffable, I felt the sentiment of being spread over all that moves and all that seems still, or all that lost beyond the reach of thought and human knowledge to the human eye invisible, yet liveth to the heart. And I'm going to suggest that if we want to kind of think about a kind of romantic conception of emotion in a particular sense, that these are sort of the things, bliss ineffable, and this idea of lost beyond the reach of thought and human knowledge to the human eye invisible, these are a portion of that. And so this is sort of there in this romantic conception, and we can see it in a larger sense if we think about the history of emotion, and in particular the idea of the passions, which was the more common sense in the 19th century, how people would talk about affective life in that terms. And it was more unbridled, it was more social, and the emotion, when we start to talk about the emotion, which is in this period that I want to talk about, it's more individual than social and more controlled. And Daniel Gross, who also has an Iowa connection, talks about this in his book, The Secret History of Emotion, and historian Peter Stearns is also someone that I'm drawing here as I talk about this. Okay, so one of the ways in which the connection between emotion and technology plays out in the period that I'm interested in, or really right before that period, that you can kind of see this in relationship to this kind of romantic idea of emotion, is around questions of spiritualism. These are the Fox sisters who were known for communicating with the dead. And actually, in the 19th century, spiritualism it became very popular as a practice, communication with the dead. And various practices like that. John Durham Peters, in his book Speaking into the Air, another Iowa connection, he talks about this also at great length. And here's an example of some spirit photography. So photographic technology, these ghost images became a way in which spiritualism was practiced. And among other people who were really involved with spiritualism, psychologist William James, he was actually the president of the Society for Psychical Research in 1896. So this is important in psychology, and James is very committed to that. But towards the end of the 19th century and in the early 20th century that I'm interested in, psychology really starts to have a backlash against spiritualism and against these practices, in particular, as they try to establish themselves as a legitimate science, as a legitimate kind of not even just only social science, but a natural science. And so, and that's an important part of the story that I want to talk about. To start getting there, I want to talk about this guy just for 1 second. This is Hugo Munsterberg. He was a psychologist. He wrote what is probably the earliest psychological study of motion pictures, his book, The Photoplay. And in this book, so he's very interested in emotion. He says in particular, to picture emotions must be the central aim of the photoplay. So that's the whole goal. And he's actually very much in praise of the emotional power of motion pictures, and in particular, the kind of uncanny emotional experience that a motion picture can create because of the camera and because how you can use that. So he's really in praise of this. And this book, too, is also, he's essentially a philosopher. And right now, psychology is still in philosophy. And if you look at this book, he talks about Beethoven, he talks about Antigone, Hamlet, Rembrandt. So he's very, very connected to philosophy and also very interested in questions about emotion. But again, as we move forward, as we start to, psychologists are very concerned about breaking with spiritualism and are concerned with establishing themselves as a legitimate science. Munsterberg's position will become less popular. And that's where I wanted to talk about a little bit, just at that period of time. And I want to just show this picture. I don't know how well you can see it. This is a picture from a book by the author that I want to spend a little bit of time talking about. He was a psychologist at the University of Iowa. His name is Christian Ruckmick. And his book, this image is from the book The Psychology of Feeling and Emotion. And this is something that he made. This is a photo montage that he made. And I actually, it's when I just saw this recently. I don't know if you could see it. So this is a photo montage, as he says, to show the great variety of facial expressions. I don't know how much you can see. There's a cow in there. There's a fish up there. There's like a chicken in there somewhere. Then, you know, a clown and then babies and all this sort of thing. And when I saw this, and I'm not going to do too much with this right now for our talk, but there's this kind of thread of Spinozan's kind of thought that runs through a lot of this stuff. And this struck me as a very kind of Spinozan thing, you know, this sort of unity of all these creatures that he was getting at here. And in fact, he actually says that Spinoza was the first person who honestly faced the emotional life. So he's actually thinking about that a little bit. But what I really want to talk about is his motion picture research. And he wrote one of the 13 Pain Fun motion picture studies with a graduate student named Wendell Diesinger. They wrote it together. They published it in 1933. And the book was called Emotional Responses of Children to the Motion Picture Situation. And it was well known at the time, and it really, in contrast to Munsterberg, whose research, he published that book in 1916. Ruckmick really starts working on this work in like 1927. So just a little over 10 years later, he's really concerned about the power of motion pictures. So here's one of the things that he says will happen to audiences as a result of watching movies. Profound mental and physiological effects of emotional order produce. The stimulus is inherently strong and undiluted by post-adolescent critical attitudes and accumulated and modifying experiences. And he says, unnatural sophistication and premature bodily stimulation will result. So now the concern is that motion pictures will have a powerful and negative effect on the body. And then his other concern actually is also about researchers themselves. So he's very concerned about psychologists, again, separating themselves from spiritualism, presenting themselves as objective. And part for him, part of that is, one part is the rejection of introspection, which was a practice that was very common for early psychologists, where you basically had people talk about their own experiences. And that's what you did. That's one of the things that he abandons. And he abandons it, and he was a strong advocate for it at one point, but he abandons it in favor of emotion measuring technologies like the psychogalvanometer that he's using here. And part of his argument for why introspection doesn't work is he says basically people really don't understand their emotions. And in fact, one of the things he says that in these experiments that they've done with having people introspect, people can't feel their own physiological responses. That they and for him, that's a reason to say that introspection doesn't work. In fact, he says, I have enraged students to the point that they said that they could almost kill me, but even then there was no report of physiological responses. So this was the kind of experiment he would do. Okay, so I would say in a very significant way, he agrees with Wordsworth that emotions are lost beyond the reach of thought and human knowledge to the human eye invisible, but his solution is the psychogalvanometer, the machine that can actually find it. And the other thing that I want to say about this is that I think is very interesting and kind of that has a bunch of very problematic kind of implications is this using technology to study technology. So he's basically using motion picture technology. The psychogalvanometer is essentially that recording technology hooked to motion picture technology, and he's using that to understand motion picture technology. Right? It's the ghost of Christian Ruckman. All right, and so this is the kind of thing that he will end up with as he studies these emotions, this kind of tracing of, he would say, the emotional responses of these children. I just want to show this really, just to kind of show an implication of this. So this is one of the scenes, this is a scene from one of the movies they analyze, and according to them, this is the most dangerous scene of the movie. And you can see, and all of the movies that they look at in this book are all, quote unquote, as they put it, oriental. They're oriental. And so we kind of get a sense of what do? Okay, they find a movie like this, and for them, they're objectively describing the movie and saying, okay, we're trying to say, how do we tell whether you respond to an emotionally significant moment? Well, we find these quote-unquote emotionally significant moments, and it turns out that they're moments like this that is a highly racialized moment. I would say that's part of exactly what they ignore about motion picture situation is how the movie and themselves are situated in a cultural moment where this is emotionally problematic in a particular kind of way. All right. I'm not going to say very much about these, but I just want to say that right now, there's a similar kind of research that's very, very popular. And popular in a way that Christian Ruckman's work wasn't even. I mean, people knew of it, but these first two books are both best-selling books. And these are books that use MRI technology to study the digital technology of the internet. Okay, I just want to say one thing about this. Again, this is another Iowa connection that you're probably going to come back to. So Damasio's not studying technology. He's not studying media technology himself. He's a neuroscientist. But there's a very interesting moment in Descartes' Air where He's studying emotion responses, so he shows images of as he puts it, social disaster, mutilation, or nudity, and that to judge how people with brain damage respond emotionally. And I would say he actually does the exact same thing that Christian Ruckman does. He doesn't show us the images or tell us what they are, but I think we can assume that they're not images that would offend everyone. That someone would probably not be offended by that nudity, and the fact that he assumes that he can pick an image that would be that, it is the sort of same thing that we kind of wash away these cultural contexts in the favor of this kind of abstract conception of emotion. Okay, so this is the part where I want to get very, very quickly to affect theory. And so this is a quote from Brian Misumi where he says, affect is, quote, that which is imperceptible but whose escape from perception cannot be perceived. And I think he's very much in this kind of the ineffable. That's really a part and parcel of how he thinks of affect. And I want, he's not the only one, but for sake of time, I'm just going to focus on him. Stephen Brown and Ian Tucker in their essay, F the Ineffable, it's a nice title for this, which is in the Affect Theory Reader, they say this. If with Misumi we define affect as in essence beyond ordinary experience, then we are in effect pushing the motive core of affective phenomena outside of analysis. The ineffability, the inexpressibility of affect becomes its key motif to be ritually repeated throughout any form of empirical work. And I would say that we could actually add a second problem, which is this problem of the path to the machine, that when we push affect outside of knowledge in a particular way, then we make it in some ways easy property of something like the psychogalvanometer or the MRI machine. Okay, so I want to end by saying a couple things about what this could mean. If we kind of take this, that maybe now, again, I don't have time to explain it in as much detail as I'd like, but if we say we might be in a moment that's similar to maybe the moment of Hugo Munsterberg before we went into the moment of Christian Ruckmick, at least from the standpoint of affect theory. A few strategies. One thing that I would say is that we need to be anti-folk psychology. In physicalism, physicalism is one of the terms that's kind of applied to some of this neurological reduction. And in arguments in philosophy of mind, they tend to talk about folk psychology. And folk psychology is the kind of person's understanding, common sense understanding of their own psychological experience. That's the thing that introspection, the psychologists like Christian Ruckmick got rid of. And there's still, within this kind of physicalist strand of philosophy, a movement against folk psychology. But I want to say we need to be anti-folk psychology. And I give the double negative on purpose to say that pro-folk psychology, if we just celebrate whatever people think about their emotions is what we're going to have, then we kind of repeat the problem from the other side, because we also locate it in the individual in a way that then we can just hook them up to a machine and measure it. But we don't want to, we can't be anti-folk psychology either in that sense, because it does the same thing. A couple other things. I think we need to be more specific and more capacious in our definitions of affect. I mean it like this. More specific, like we need to think about when we talk about affect, we're talking about it in a moment in time, just like Christian Ruckmick was speaking in a moment in time. And what is that moment in time doing for how we think about it? So we're sort of, it's sort of like a rhetoric of emotion. We're thinking, how is our moment forming how we're thinking about it? What are the implications of that? But also more capacious, because I know for some people, it's very important to separate affect and feeling and emotion. But I think when we do that, we might sort of ignore some ways in which how, again, someone like Christian Ruckmick, I would say, how in that moment they were talking about emotion right before that moment is very similar to how affect is thinking, we're talking about affect now. And it's important to draw that line, I think, because it has important implications for us in terms of what we do. The last one I'll say is that we need to have a critique of the rhetoric of the technological sublime. The technological sublime is an idea from Leo Marx that every new technology is met by this mixture of horror, of kind of awe and horror. And we kind of see that, like what that did for Munsterberg and Ruckmick were both in that. And Munsterberg celebrated it, and Ruckmick was very against it on the one hand, but also his idea of the psychogalvanometer bought into it too. He really believed in the power of these recording technologies. It gave the psychogalvanometer an objective ability to record emotion. It gave motion pictures a power to physiologically affect people. So we need to do that as well. And I call this, I won't explain this right now because I think I'm probably out of time, but romanticism without mystification. That we want to hold on to some of that ineffable quality of it. I think that's very important, as Masumi notes. But we also want to be careful about those things that are a part of it, which lead us down that path to the machine. Thanks.
So this paper today is on Chris Crocker. Are people familiar with him and the Leave Britney Alone video from a couple of years ago? Just a show of hands. How many people have seen it or at least know about it, even if you didn't watch it on YouTube? I don't know if you looked around the room as you raised your hands, but that's a pretty good percentage of people, so I probably won't show it then. I do, however, let's see. There we go. Sorry, let me just, the irony of a digital talk where you can't get the tech to work. There we go. I do want to show just maybe 20 seconds of this video, just so everyone, if you are not familiar with Chris Crocker, you can get a little bit of a sense of him.
Hey, what up, everybody? This is Chris. We got another... I'm still kind of blowing smoke at my ears because the haters just refuse to give it up, you know. And so the people that be saying, you know, this and that, y'all. Girl, I don't understand. Look at this, girl. To the bitches that want to fight me. To the bitches that want to fight me. Girl, look at this bitch. You want to fight me. Girl, what is it, girl? What I got to hide, nigga? What I got to hide, huh? Because, bitch, you want to fight somebody, bitch? Let's go, girl. I've seen it right here in USA.
Okay. You get a sense of what these videos can look like. Let me go back to the Prezi now. I haven't taught that video or any of Chris Crocker's videos yet, nor have I taught the documentary of which he is subject, entitled Me at the Zoo. This is surprising to me, given the fact that I teach classes on desire, and these videos are all about his desire, often to be, it's either a metonymic desire to be next to Britney Spears, or a metaphoric desire. Sometimes he wants to be Britney Spears. And in his bedroom, he had countless pictures of her stuck all over the walls around the time of his production of the Leave Britney Alone video. And I also teach gender and sexuality studies, so it would be a perfect video to look at in media artifact section of that introductory course on gender and sexuality studies. And as Alex mentioned, I also work on the figure of the artist Monkey, and what is Chris Crocker if not a would-be or failed artist figure for me? So this piece is my attempt to understand why I haven't been teaching this material, and also to think my way through how I might start teaching it in my classrooms. Right, because he's effervescent, he's got this great quiddity to him that I'm fascinated by, but I'm not teaching him. And this piece also picks up on my best friend Nick Salvato's piece in TDR from 2009 on YouTube and the boundaries of professional and amateur performance, a good portion of which focused on Chris Crocker. So I'm picking up the mantle to track what has happened to this individual since that moment. So to accompany the opening credits of their 2012 documentary, Me at the Zoo, directors Chris Morkabel and Valerie Veach filmed their subject, internet sensation and human meme, Chris Crocker, coming into focus on screen. As the blurriness dissolves, the camera trains its gaze on Crocker, shirtless, clad only in cut-off jean shorts and Converse shoes, with a head of tangled, shoulder-length blonde hair standing amidst lush greenery. Wherever Crocker is in this footage seems a far remove from the claustrophobic confines of his grandmother's Bristol, Tennessee home, where he shot, against the backdrop of one of his own bedroom curtains, viral videos that have since been viewed over 270 million times to date, including that 2007 video, Leave Britney Alone. The YouTube effort that catapulted that already established prosumer to household name status. And I should note that as of this week when I checked, that video alone is currently at over 47 million hits. These are crazy numbers. So let's see if I can get back to where I need to be here. Okay, that's a bit on Bergson. That's more of a placeholder for me when I come back to think of this again. But I think the Bergson really helps think about what's going on in gesture in some of these videos. But I didn't realize that we were going to spend so much time with that video, the Neapolitan video yesterday. So I didn't mean to come in and give another crying video about comportment. So since so many of you have seen it, I'll go to the next slide and continue. But this opening image, the focal point is his bird chest with its visible ribs and stark tank top lines. His chest seems to be a marker of both childlike vulnerability and defiance, a laying bare of Crocker's complicated trans identity, and a perfect figure for what writer Eli Sanders referred to as Crocker's, quote, nakedly furious presentation of effeminacy. Crocker's visible tan lines give us a sense that we are seeing what is normally covered. Here is a forbidden and obscene body. After the camera pans upwards from his feet, Chris speaks directly to it as he cites a lyric from Spears. It's like Britney says in her song Circus, there's only two types of people in the world, the ones who entertain and the ones who observe. That Crocker considers himself and belongs in the former camp is the donne of the documentary, even as it charts the downturn in its subject's relevancy. As the title of the film appears on screen, and that title is borrowed from the first video ever uploaded to YouTube by one of its founders, Me at the Zoo, it is accompanied by the sound of clicking computer keys, and a jump cut moves Crocker's body, now pixelated, to the foreground. Reconstituted from these pixelated parts, Crocker seems to break the fourth wall and step through the screen, much like the villainous Samara in The Ring, I don't know if you've seen that movie. Mukabel and Veach's next shot are of their own documentary camera and handheld tapeless video playback device with its flat, glossy, prophylactic screen. So Crocker is once again out of focus and relegated to the background. While this opening presiding image of the film is in some sense an obvious choice to introduce the documentary subject, after all, Crocker's videos are routinely consumed on flat technics, such as laptops, iPhones, and tablets, one would be hard-pressed to argue that flatness is a constitutive feature of Crocker's performative repertoire, his online affect, his particular brand of histrionics, the very specificity of which make his videos ripe for parody, and his citation of flaming black men, black drag queens, and trannies from Compton, whom he befriended on an LA-based chat line, are anything but flat. And yet, the documentary not only thematizes flatness, but also cultivates it as a feeling with which it leaves its audience. And this is, I think, why I'm having a little bit of difficulty navigating my way around how to teach this documentary, how then to use it in the classroom. And I'd like to use Me at the Zoo as a jumping off point for a broader discussion of the privileging of flatness in our digital age and the often obscured problems that accompany that privileging. Here I'm not thinking primarily about the kinds of prosthetic intimacies that attend our use of flat devices. Elsewhere, I've suggested that while there are principled reasons to be anxious about these attenuated and mediated intimacies and the perils that they may entail, we might also consider how such online experiences can prove enabling. Though now, I confess, I'm not so sure. I couldn't live without my iPhone in the same way that you're hamstrung by not having your electric shaver here in some sense. Rather, I'm thinking about the attrition of agency that characterizes and is, in fact, built into our everyday digital and online lives. Moving from the self-spectacularizations of internet sensations like Chris Crocker to Silicon Valley pioneer Jaron Lanier's cautionary account of poorly considered digital design, including programming in what he terms a flat global structure, and Zadie Smith's meditation on Generation Facebook, I would like to consider how flatness has become not merely a desirable feature of our handheld techniques, but also a compulsory trait and affect for those most plugged into the social network. And perhaps more problematic still, for those of us anchoring our critical inquiry and teaching in the fields of digital and new media studies. So before I leave Me at the Zoo, I want to talk briefly about a few representative moments from that film that will, I hope, shore up my claim about how the film leaves its audience. In an early scene, spliced from his own footage, Crocker turns his digital camera on himself to discuss his transgender identity with his Pentecostal grandmother. He tells her, "There's this theory, and it's that your genitalia doesn't define your gender. It's what's in your heart." His grandmother's pithy response, "It's what's on your birth certificate," collapses and flattens her grandson's humanity into a single document, a piece of paper that trumps Crocker's protestation that his identity is at once less tangible and housed in his spirit. Even as Crocker pronounces the importance of both depth and affective response to his gender identity, he tells his grandmother, "It's in my heart." And he also says, "You're supposed to feel my spirit when you talk to me." He comes up against flat refusal. If the understanding of flatness accompanies, in some very real sense, the understanding of depth, then it is in moments like these that Crocker apprehends how flatness is an elimination of depth. He may come to understand its construction precisely because he knows firsthand how depth gets eliminated. Having traced the trajectory of Crocker's cultural relevancy, the documentary filmmakers chronicle what happened once Crocker's reality TV deal falls through. Crocker finds himself in LA making club appearances for money, and the footage of him on stage is every bit as awkward as Spears' lackluster performance of Gimme More that Crocker defended so vociferously in his Leave Britney Alone video. He admits, "I'd go out on stage and people expected some kind of show out of me. I didn't really know how to perform outside of my bedroom." Crocker's confusion, crystallized in the ambiguity of his phrase, "some kind of show," doesn't square with his clear sense of himself as a viral video auteur, a sense that could only be encouraged by the prosumer logic that has YouTube co-founder Chad Hurley asserting, "That's what we see ourselves as doing, creating a stage for everyone to participate on." And an unidentified voiceover in the documentary announcing, "You can't just create a viral video. It needs to be very organic. It needs to be grassroots. It needs to be very real. And the users will realize what's real and what's not. It's really an art much more than a science." Except Crocker had cracked the formula to create a viral video. It's just that the formula didn't translate to performance space beyond the bedroom curtains of his bedroom stage, even those as putatively amateurish as the nightclub and the reality television platform. Nevertheless, in the penultimate video of his that the filmmakers include, Crocker philosophizes about his failure to convert digital fame to another format, about what his flatness as a no longer relevant but still widely known figure may signify. While Crocker's words may bear the tincture of wishful thinking, and while his self-awareness may not even closely approach Oscar Wilde's elegance in De Profundis when he describes his sense of himself as a man who stood in symbolic relations to the art and culture of my age, the video reveals how Crocker may in fact stand in symbolic relation to the digital culture of his age. He says, "You wouldn't think that people would be mad at me for not being famous anymore, but they are. They're like, it's like they wanted to vicariously feel fame through me. With so many people telling me I'm not famous anymore, and I'm not famous, and I'm a has-been and all these things, it got me thinking. If so many people are determined to make me think I'm not famous, that counts for something. You know, and Paris Hilton's in her own class. She's famous for being famous, and I guess I'm one of the first to be famous for not being famous." So at the pinnacle of his self-spectacularization, before he was content to count merely for something, Crocker provided vicarious thrills for his fans and detractors alike, who could share in his fame and or infamy by creating their own parody videos of his productions, albeit with different valences. These individuals who, per Crocker's perhaps inflated estimation, feel fame through him, surrogate for those who might be able to feel his spirit in less mediated and attenuated ways. He settles for surface over depth. Here I don't mean to equate fame with depth, but rather to suggest that the YouTube efforts that viral videos inspire are second-order expressions, made of fragmentary reactions to first-order expression. And I suppose we could go here one step further to quibble about how original Crocker's videos are, given their own overt citation of the performance habitus of black drag queens, and for that matter, Britney Spears. As second-order expressions, those parodic videos represent layers of flatness. They constitute an unsatisfying depth, much like the final video image of Crocker, in which we see his reflection in a vanity mirror. We watch with him as he gazes into the mirror and strokes both his face and then his reflection in a highly stylized gesture of narcissism before he holds up his laptop camera to the mirror to create a mise en abyme of infinite regress. Since the documentary wrapped, Crocker has further refined his sense of his own symbolic relation to digital culture. In a web chat hosted by Rich Jizwiak of Gawker.com and conducted just prior to the premiere of Me at the Zoo on HBO, Crocker addressed the hatred and qualified forms of recognition with which he met as an internet meme. "I was no longer a person to people, rather a person, persona." And he typed that word out in all caps. His statement gets at a differential allocation of vulnerability that depends not only on homophobia and transphobia, but also on his very status as an online presence. Crocker was not fully legible as human when he was fully legible as meme. And this is never clearer than in the documentary's depiction of the backlash against him, where one representative detractor pronounces, "If nobody watches him, he doesn't exist." Crocker's digital life raises the ontological question of what it means to be a person to people online. And sandwiched in the middle of Me at the Zoo is a brief history of the internet, complete with now quaint clips of a very young Katie Couric and Bryant Gumbel asking each other, "What is the internet?" They want to get that stuff taken down, by the way. Somebody got in real trouble at CBS, I think, for putting this material on the web recently. Embedded within this collage is an unidentified clip, seemingly from a local news report, a letter about the merits of the internet from Patty in Toronto, who passionately intones, "It has more soul than any human being I know. It has more soul than any human..." While we might wonder about poor Patty's acquaintances, we might also ponder what it means for someone like Patty to assert such unqualified recognition, to allege the humanity of the internet. Which flat structures encourage, position, or situate Patty to make such a claim? So in tandem with my thinking about the documentary, I've been reading Jaron Lanier's 2010 text, "You Are Not a Gadget, a Manifesto," and I've been reading it with no small measure of anxiety, an anxiety perhaps exacerbated or softened at turns by my attendance at a series of talks about the future of digital humanities at the liberal arts college where I teach. A programmer known as the father of virtual reality technology, Lanier is neither a Luddite nor a doomsday crier. He is someone who has been plugged squarely into the digital revolution of the last 30 years. Lanier's book poses the question of what happens when we stop shaping technology to fit our needs and technology starts shaping us. He describes how the features of current web design and function have grown out of programming decisions that are now decades old and calcified or locked in. How the crucial choices of the first web designers, such as making one's presence online anonymous, have had enormous and unintended effects. He argues that extensions to our being, such as remote eyes and ears, webcams and mobile phones, and expanded memory, the world of details you can search for online, become the structures by which we connect to the world and other people. And these structures can, in turn, tinker with your philosophy by direct manipulation of your cognitive experience. So he writes, when developers of digital technologies design a program that requires you to interact with the computer as if it were a person, they ask you to accept in some corner of your brain that you might also be conceived of as a program. When they design an internet service that is edited by a vast anonymous crowd, they are suggesting that a random crowd of humans is an organism with a legitimate point of view. His concern is that platforms like Twitter and templates such as those on WordPress or social networking sites like Facebook situate users to believe that objectively described events define them, just as they would define a machine. So we might consider here the question with which Evan Williams launched the Twitter platform, what are you doing? So in this sense, Lanier offers a very useful riposte to Clay Shirky's book on cognitive surplus, which was also published in 2010. And Shirky argues that people are much more creative and constructive now that we have the internet because we're spending all this time on Wikipedia, and he says we do that as a pair, compared to the 2 billion hours we spend watching TV, which he compares to the gin craze, and I say bring on the Tanqueray. I don't know what's wrong with watching TV. I'd rather do that than post things on Wikipedia. But anyway, a lot of the content online is half of the bits, in fact, coursing through the internet originated as television, movies, and traditional commercial content. So this is just one measure of flatness, the mashups and the supercuts that exhaust original content. Participatory culture comes not so much to signify cognitive surplus as it does cognitive recycling or repurposing. So I'll just say one last thing because I know I'm out of time. When you're thinking about these structures online that build from this original programming, it's a flat global structure. It gives us this whiff of freedom. And that goes some way to explaining Patty from Toronto's sense that the internet has more soul than any human being she knows. But is our Patty finally a disciple of Deleuze and assemblage theory? Isn't hers a flat ontology by which the internet becomes a unique, singular individual differing in spatio-temporal scale but not in ontological status? A more optimistic view of flatness, more along the line of Shirky's take than Lanier's, would hold that online life and the participatory culture it affords can offer new skills that increase one's capacities to affect and be affected. But here I'd like both to cite Delander's notion that an augmentation of capacities, the acquisition of new skills, is a deterritorializing process that can destabilize personal identity, and to modify his example of the child who learns to ride a bicycle, right? A skill that allows the child to enter into novel assemblages, the assemblage that the human body forms with bicycle, a piece of solid ground, and a gravitational field, for example. What of the assemblage that the human body forms with digital camera, USB cable, laptop, and bedroom curtain? And the yet larger assemblage that includes not only YouTube users responding to the call to broadcast yourself, but also passive YouTube subscribers and the casual visitors redirected to by Google or a gossip blog to the latest internet meme. Online communities destabilize spatial boundaries by eliminating the need for co-presence and increase internal heterogeneity within the social assemblage. We might quibble with Delander and Patty from Toronto about the ontological status of the internet and the social assemblages it fosters, but I'm finding it hard to argue with Zadie Smith when she describes her feeling of distance from Generation Facebook in her essay Generation Y. She writes, "We have different ideas of what a person is or should be. I often worry that my idea of personhood is nostalgic, irrational, inaccurate." She later compares Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg to the pages of the website he created. He is, quote, "controlled but dull, bright and clean but uniformly plain, non-ideological, affectless," end quote. Smith describes not only Zuckerberg's flatness, but also the corresponding flattening out of quiddities that accompanies the aim to be liked by more and more people. If our essay echoes Lanier's concern for the leeching of empathy and humanity that attends the process of designing ourselves to suit online digital models of us, then Me at the Zoo offers concrete and oftentimes harrowing examples of the leeching of empathy, of the flat refusals to be a person to people online. Thank you very much.
To refresh.
Nothing? Missing computer. Oh, there we go. Laptop.
No, still.
You know what I might be able to do is just play it so we can just hear the audio.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Fine. Yeah, absolutely. Let's not waste time. Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. I want to acknowledge my co-author, Joe Miles, who couldn't attend, as Alex said, and also acknowledge the generous funding of the National Science Foundation that supported this project and hopefully will continue to support it as we grow and develop our research into LGBT affirmative therapy, which is what I'm going to talk about today. So leading up to and intensifying after the declassification of homosexuality from the DSM in 1974, there has been a veritable explosion of research, training, and graduate training and practice in what is heterogeneously described as LGBT psychology, gay affirmative therapy, and LGBT affirmative therapy. This body of knowledge includes research and educational materials in psychology that explicitly aim to produce depathologizing science about LGBT people with which practitioners of psychological science, that is to say, counselors and therapists, may conduct identity-affirming therapies that help sexual minorities and gender non-conforming individuals negotiate the complexities of mental health in the historical social context of structural heterosexism. A few figures speak to this dynamic and expanding archive. So during the decade of declassification, 10 articles with the keyword sexual orientation were published in the flagship journal of the American Psychological Association, that's American Psychologist. During the 2000s alone, there were 39, four times more. In the Journal of Counseling Psychology, the flagship journal of that subfield, there were two articles about sexual orientation from the 1960s through the 1980s. In the 1990s, there were 7, and then 25 in the 2000s alone, plus a special issue on LGBT psychology featuring the leaders of the field. Just last month, the APA Division for Sexual Orientation and Gender Diversity Issues, Division 44, launched its first journal, which is the only APA journal dedicated to the study of sexual orientation. The theme of Division 44's conference this summer at the annual convention of the American Psychological Association is Taking Our Place at the Table. In epistemic terms, the latter decades of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st century may be described as an opening up of psychotherapy as discourse and disciplinary apparatus to a new ontology of sexuality and sexual identity. Psychotherapy is certainly not the only disciplinary space that dealt with such a transformation in recent decades. Of course, medicine, biology, and the law have undergone and continue to wrestle with the implications of depathologized, natural, and decriminalized forms of homosexuality that are at once assumed and dynamic objects of disciplinary and institutional knowledge. But in the context of psychotherapy, the new potentially healthy and happy queer subject presents epistemic, ontological, ethical, and practical problems that are multifarious and interconnected. Today, I'll foreground the ontological concerns, but should not elide the social justice at stake in such a project. Psychology has not historically been kind to queer people. While queer people disproportionately access mental health services either by choice, coercion, necessity, or force. How they interact with applied psychologists in institutional settings is about a lot of things, but it is always about the potential for harm and injustice. As a kind of disciplinary archive of feelings, The genealogy of LGBT psychotherapy in the West suggests a series of overlapping and interdependent, intricately choreographed moves from pathologization through incorporation and now into the era of affirmation. In the last decade, especially, psychologists have raised questions about what constitutes the affirmation of queer identities in clinical practice and what distinguishes LGBT affirmative therapy from other approaches. Probing the discourse for what these affirmative therapies are and do, psychologists implicitly invoke questions about what the rest of psychology does to and with queer people. In other words, how does normal psychology not affirm or even deny queer affect? Is LGBT affirmative therapy a new kind of therapy altogether, or simply a toolkit to supplement other theoretical orientations, such as cognitive behavioral or psychodynamic therapy? Are LGBT issues a new competency, like racial and ethnic minority psychology, disability awareness, and the psychology of gender? And if LGBT issues are included under the umbrella of multicultural competency, then how are psychologists studying and theorizing multiculturalism and attending or not attending to the intersectional dynamics imminent in any attempt to conceptualize subjects as situated within complex structural dimensions of power and inequality? What might be obvious to this group but is less evident in psychological discourse is the precarious co-constitutive relationship between these new clinical practices and the ontological constitution of queer subjects in both psychological science and practice. Our interdisciplinary research seeks specifically to interrogate empirically the knowledge-making practices of the new so-called affirmative psychology of sexual orientation. We take a feminist queer sociology of scientific knowledge approach to investigating the form and content of the dynamic field of LGBT psychology and the ways in which these knowledges are congealing into norms and procedures for the treatment of sexual minorities and trans people who interact with therapists and other clinicians in the context of mental health institutions, such as college counseling centers and independent therapy practices, as well as other clinical settings, including hospitals and prisons. We agree with philosopher Ian Hacking's assertion that there is, quote, no general story to be told about making up people, end quote. But we seek answers regarding the ongoing particular story of queer psychology in the 21st century that concerns not only the making up of queer subjects, but the uptaking of queer affects into disciplinary psychology. Our work explores how the affective lives of queer people have become technosemiotic materials with which psychologists co-create scientific knowledge and new technologies of clinical practice with their research participants and clients. Though this process of co-creation does not presume egalitarian relations between scientists, practitioners, and the queer people with whom this new gay science is choreographed. We are concerned with and about a dynamic that Sarah Ahmed succinctly describes accordingly, quote, to be affected by something is to evaluate that thing, end quote. The first stage of this research involved a critical discourse analysis of a newly produced archive of psychotherapy training videos released in 2011 by Alexander Street Press, a for-profit publisher of educational training materials. This three-volume series, which is award-winning and widely disseminated, mostly through university library systems, is titled Counseling and Therapy in Video and covers a variety of themes, including basic topics, such as how to develop a healthy working alliance with a new client, as well as more specialized domains, including those categorized as pertaining to sexual orientation. The sexual orientation videos in volumes 1 through 3 of the series include content created since 2000 and represent three general types of videos. Documentary style footage on a topic such as HIV/AIDS or straight privilege, as well as both simulated and actual therapy sessions produced by leading academic psychologists. Using a team-based approach, including the two PIs, that's Dr. Miles and myself, and a counseling psychology graduate student, we watched and analyzed all the sexual orientation videos, which was over 1,800 minutes, and then used theoretical sampling to select a subsample of 16 videos to subject to the analytic rigors of grounded theory analysis and situational analysis, which are two widely used qualitative methods in critical social science research on science, technology, and medicine. And I'm happy to talk more about those methods during the Q&A. But most importantly, and reflecting the critical constructionist epistemology undergirding these approaches, both grounded theory and situational analysis are driven by questions, not hypotheses. In this case, a series of ontological concerns. How do these videos make up sexual orientation? Furthermore, what constitutes an LGBT issue? Where and what is the science of sexual orientation in these discourses? And how are these videos productive of norms around how we should train or produce LGB and sometimes T affirmative psychotherapists? Finally, how and what does sexual orientation have to do with other parts of the self and society? Now, I wanted to show a brief clip, but instead we're just going to listen to the sound, the audio from a video called Queer Theory in Action, in which two LGBT psychologists pretend to translate the insights of Butlerian and Foucauldian queer theoretical perspectives on sexuality and gender into therapeutic practice. Now, obviously, there's a bit of unacknowledged irony here, in so much as the therapists earnestly explicate the insights of queer theory, which for Foucault was largely predicated on a protracted critique of psychology as biopolitical violence. But that's what makes the video fascinating. In this clip, an actual therapist, a white queer woman, Julie Tilson, and her client, Tigernan, a trans man of color, are discussing the client's challenging relationship with his family. Now, let's see if you can hear. If not, I can read the transcript if it doesn't work. All right, we're going to be fine, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. Is it going to go? Not waste time, I will just read it to you. What would your mom say? Tig responds, that I need to listen more. She would like you to listen more, okay, yeah. And would she say you are, and you're listening more, that she would come into understanding your similarities just as you would come into understanding hers? Tig responds, that's what she would physically say, but what she would really mean, and maybe this is just how I'm interpreting it, is that she would like me to be more. She'd like me to do what she wants, Tilson replies, which is to be a girl. Tig says, be a girl, but go to college, focus on school, live at home, things that aren't conducive to a happy living environment for me. The therapist replies, do you believe that your mom is so passionate about the idea of being a mom to a daughter, of having you be a girl, that she would be willing to see you sacrifice your happiness? Tig says, absolutely. I think because she herself had made a lot of sacrifices for happiness, that she thinks everybody should do that, or that's the right way to be, and she's in so much pain because of it. Tilson says, okay, in what ways is having witnessed your mom's pain also been something that inspired you to do what makes you happy? Tig says, yeah, that's very true. I don't think I've ever thought of that. Tig continues to talk about his mother's experience as an immigrant and the unhappy marriage that his mother finds herself in. I wish that you could have seen the interaction between the two of them, but I'll say now that this scene illustrates one of the key tensions that emerged very early on in our analysis. If the videos collectively suggest that LGBT affirmative therapy is a kind of multicultural competency, then that implies their pedagogical objective is to prepare therapists to draw upon that competency during moments in which the client's presenting problem represents something having to do with sexual orientation broadly and sexual minority and sometimes gender nonconforming identification specifically. Competency then represents both a knowledge, that is, familiarity with issues that are specific to the population, and a therapeutic sensitivity, the ability to dynamically deploy that knowledge when therapeutically appropriate. In the session that I read, the therapist persistently brings the conversation around to conflict about identity and inequality, namely Tig's gender identity and transition. Tig, meanwhile, directs the conversation towards his challenging relationship with his mother, which he attributes to multiple reasons, including his decision not to go to college, to not focus on school, to not live at home, etc. While the therapist foregrounds the gender and sexuality issues, the client suggests that communication problems are the key issue in his struggle with his mother. Now, the therapist may be offering insight in the form of, have you ever thought about this before? But may also be taking what we could term a determinist essentialist approach to LGBT affirmative therapy, in which the client's social identities supersede all other factors in assessing problems, conceptualizing mental health, and developing strategies for effective counseling. Now, such an approach would, of course, be contrary to the aims of queer theory, which even Tilson, the therapist, says seeks to destabilize tacit notions of identity and undermine social and cultural systems that group individuals into arbitrary categories. Now, in another video, Counseling Gay and Lesbian People of Color, Multiple Identities, Part 1, the client explicitly asks, is it a gay thing or a me thing? Now, in contrast to the video that we just watched, the therapist in Multiple Identities, who also is a person of color, does not assume that the presenting concern is driven exclusively or even primarily by the client's sexual orientation. The therapist explores with the client other aspects of identity, including immigrant status, ethnicity, gender, social class, and his family dynamics. For example, what it was like expressing or not expressing emotion in his family. These cases are two among many in the video archive that reveal a contestation over LGBT therapeutic competency. Specifically, we see this competency as a locus of discursive activity about the differences between and interdependencies among knowledge of LGBT issues, which is primarily cognitive and political, and therapeutic sensitivity, which is framed as an affective and social technique, a form of what Jackie Orr calls psychopower. To register when and how to use one's knowledge of LGBT issues effectively in the interest of promoting positive affect. We might recast the astute young client's question from the therapist's perspective. Is it a gay thing or a you thing? Quote, happiness is not just how subjects speak of their own desires, but also what they want to give and receive from others, writes Ahmed in The Promise of Happiness. What actual clients receive from their therapists and what they contribute to the affective knowledges and knowledges of affect in LGBT psychology is the next frontier of our research, which will move from the mediated archive into actual therapy sessions at sites around the country. In the meantime, we continue to contend with the psychotechniques of the training archives, which are busy with the work of writing what Ahmed calls happiness scripts, which she pointedly describes as, quote, straightening devices, ways of aligning bodies with what is already lined up. The points that accumulate as lines can be performatives. A point on a line can be a demand to stay in line. To deviate from the line is to be threatened with unhappiness. Happiness scripts are powerful even when we fail or refuse to follow them, even when desires deviate from their lines. And I'm going to wrap up here with a discussion of ontological choreography, which is Charis Thompson's concept of ontological choreography is helpful to make sense of all this messy discourse in so much as it denotes how individuals and highly contested and emergent social scientific formations, such as contemporary LGBT psychotherapy, engage in creating performance of meaning-making, or engage in creative performance of meaning-making through and within their overlapping social worlds. As Thompson defines it, ontological choreography describes how, quote, what might appear to be an undifferentiated hybrid mess is actually a deftly balanced coming together of things that are generally considered parts of different ontological orders, end quote. In the context of our research, we find the social actors in the archive making meaning about competency through the dynamic coordination of emotional, political, scientific, life historical, and sociocultural dimensions of contemporary LGBT life and science. Whereas one might normally view individual differences, including personality, social identities, including race, sexual orientation, and even political affiliations, affect, such as shame and pride, bodies, including hormones and somatic responses, and technoscience, such as the Diagnostical and Statistical Manual, psychotropics, and cognitive behavioral therapy, to constitute discrete ontological orders, like part of the self, part of nature, part of science, part of society. The clients and therapists in the archive draw upon their experiences in all of these registers of human activity to manufacture LGBT affirmative therapy. This choreography is both deeply affective and intricately intentional. These diverse social actors do this choreography, in Thompson's terms, to, quote, get on with the task at hand, making up science. Thank you.
So as Brian promised, I'll indeed have a go at Damasio, but you'll see he furrows my brow for a different reason. Let me see if I can. I'm not very good at PowerPoint. All right. In the spring of 2013, a group of researchers at the University of Iowa enthusiastically reported fear. Their joy stemmed from the unexpected occurrence of fear, for they gave fright to someone whom they believed was constitutionally fearless. The group, led by Justin Feinstein, upended decades of conviction about a part of the brain essential to the effective formula for humans experiencing fear and panic. That part of the brain in question is the amygdala. A typical human has two amygdalae, each of which is a relatively small group of clustered neurons located deep within each side of one's temporal lobes. What the amygdala do or do not is contested terrain. Research questions the amygdala provide for neuroscientists are legion, and the one studied in Iowa City for the past decades, for instance, by John Wemmy and Antonio Damasio, largely reckon that a lack of amygdala creates a lack of fear. But for whom and how? The woman at the center of the Iowa team's 2013 report is called patient SM, and she has neither of her amygdala. The 48-year-old mother of three, known as patient SM, sometimes written up as SM or as patient 046, has been of neurological, neuroscientific, psychological, and experimental focus at the University of Iowa in some way since 1986, when she was 20 years old. She is diagnosed with Urbach-Wythe, a genetic orphan disease with varied dermatological and or neurological symptoms. In this instance, both of patient SM's amygdala calcified, hardened, and eventually became lesions in her brain by the time she had finished her teens. Just 2 years earlier, in 2011, Justin Feinstein and colleagues subjected patient SM to several affect-loaded environments. In an exotic pet store with snakes and spiders, walking through a haunted house and watching film clips of scary movies. Patient SM experienced no fear. And while nearly a century ago it was discovered that CO2 inhalation can trigger panic attacks, this possibility was never attempted on individuals with amygdala lesions. So in the 2013 lab experiment, patient SM was exposed to 35% carbon dioxide, which, according to the report, triggered fear and panic. Now, I find this a really interesting proposal. The takeaway lesson for the Iowa team in the 2013 report is that, contrary to our hypothesis and adding an important clarification to the widely held belief that the amygdala is essential for fear, these results indicate that the amygdala is not required for fear and panic evoked by CO2 inhalation. The experiment seems to expose a way to outsmart a particular pathology. For neuroscientists in general, the results problematize a claim of localizable fear mechanism in the brain. That is to say, it questions the idea that fear could have a universal cranial address. With regard to the effects involved, neuroscientist Joseph Ledeau takes umbrage with the Feinstein team's interchangeable use of the term fear to describe both feelings and brain bodily responses elicited by threats. For Ledeau, it represents an uncritical interpretation and deployment of the concept of fear because the language implies that the defense mechanisms go hand in hand with the feeling of fear. This particular dispute, whether or not circulating affects register through conscious awareness or unconscious reflex, plays into familiar debates on intentionality that both Ruth Lees and David Bulmer, for instance, identify in their expose of affect studies in the humanities. The seduction, I fear, for cultural critics of affect studies is that an object like the Feinstein study is recruited to service a wider ontological argument. Papoulias and Callard, for instance, write that the turn to affect in cultural studies is accompanied by a dependency on particular citations from neuroscientific and developmental psychology literature. What I wish to avert is to treat the Feinstein study in the service of a debate, to risk flattening the object into just an example of a grander theory or theorization. On its face, the Feinstein study exposes a previous ignorance, but it also describes how it is possible to expose someone to fear and panic. That is, even if we naively understand carbon dioxide gas as effective, that it is literally in the air, then we can think about the circulation of affects as a type of exposure. Exposure, in this case, defines how the version of fear offered functions, and that it is achieved through narrative exposition particular to the literacies required for its readability. Mika Ball, in her work Double Exposures, suggests that the triple meaning of the verb to expose, exposition, expose, and exposure, constitutes the field of cultural analysis, for it defines cultural behavior, if not culture, as such. The verb refers to the action of making a public presentation, where the exposure involved is an act of producing meaning. Exposure acquires intelligibility, therefore, in exposition, in the public telling and sharing and reproduction of ideas. Giorgio Agamben includes writing and technologies of storytelling as Foucauldian apparatuses connected with power. those things that have in some way the capacity to capture, orient, determine, intercept, model, control, or secure the gestures, behaviors, and disciplines in cultural negotiations. Therefore, I want to approach the 2013 Feinstein Report as an object in its own terms. And this nexus of narrativity, power, and articulation ushered through exposure cues my analysis of the particular narrative politics densely texturing this object. Here, I want to press that a neuroscientific explanation engages the logic of storytelling. To understand fear is to grasp a narrative, showing how one affect leads to another and how one affect can overcome something else to produce a similar exposure. The concept of fear is at play in the Feinstein study, and the plot of fear is what narratives shape. My reading will not offer a neurological methodology or an ontology of affect. Rather, it engages a theory of narrative in determining the ways cultural objects productively problematize rather than merely illustrate those existing ideological frameworks. So first, I'll look at the ways that the Iowa team's positioning of patient SM quotes a history of character-based case studies in medical literature. And secondly, I'll argue that the specific citations embedded in that report are freighted by a politics of storycraft, which exposes the narrative entanglements the cultural critics of affect studies and neuroscientific researchers perform. But first, a story. Just outside Cavendish, Vermont, in the summer of 1848, a man named Phineas Gage prepared a bed for the Rutland and Burlington Railroad by placing explosive powder into holes drilled into rock. Gage used a tamping iron to pack the explosives, and at one point in the afternoon, as a result of accidental explosion, the roughly meter-long iron blew completely through his head. It entered through his face, under the left cheekbone, exited the top of his skull, and landed some 25 meters behind him. Gage survived that day and lived for another 11 and a half years before dying of epilepsy in San Francisco. The accident obviously left a severe lesion in Gage's brain. Psychological changes are reported to have occurred as a result. The physician who treated Gage in Cavendish wrote some 20 years after the accident that Gage's mind was radically changed, so decidedly so that his friends and acquaintances said he was no longer Gage. As with patient SM, taking up study of the damaged brain is thought to yield insight into how the healthy brain functions. Thus, in his afterlife, Phineas Gage enjoys a long history of appropriation. The story of Gage has been taken up as a morality tale of alcoholism. It's associated with yarns about a carnival freak show, is featured as an anthropological object, is utilized as a union worker story, and has become a theater production. In the year 2000, Malcolm McMillan took up the uses and abuses of the Phineas Gage story as an object of cultural study in its own right. He found that Gage appears in nearly 60% of the introductory textbooks of psychology published between 1983 and 1998. Like Phineas Gage, patient SM stars in several recent 101-level psychology textbooks as a character witness to evidence the amygdala's role in emotion. I'll give one example to demonstrate the conclusion that I take from it. In one book, the story of patient SM appears in a poll quote bubbled entitled, "Neuroscience applies to your world. Is fear good for us?" The excerpt teaches students how, quote, "on the surface, you might think that living a fear-free life might be great, but a closer look at SM shows the darker side of fearlessness." It goes on to briefly report how one-time patient SM could not be bothered by being held up at knife point here in Iowa City. While there's a tale here about the consequences of having superhuman abilities, what's interesting to me here is that the 2011 Feinstein study, the one with snakes and spiders, is reporting this knife point episode as an anecdotal aside. The Iowa team certainly were not present collecting data when this occurred to patient SM, but felt this self-reported memoir important enough to further evidence their findings about the amygdala. In fact, self-reported levels of fear and panic and what the patients reported are one of two levels of observation propelling the 2013 report. The report strives to incorporate three biomarkers, respiratory rate, heart rate, and skin conductance, but the supplemental material describing the study's methods note that most of the biomarker data for the amygdala damaged subjects was unrecordable or corrupted, and that the researchers, in fact, went to great lengths to inductively include publishable graphs and charts. The second level of observation is from the researchers themselves, who witnessed patient SM's response to CO2 as grasping for air, distressed facial expressions, and displaying escape behavior, for example, ripping off the inhalation mask. In other words, fear exposes itself through narration. It is in these stories in which the fearful, panicky events can ultimately be exposed. So what I'm arguing here is that the quotation of narrative sketches, whether through Phineas Gage or Payson SM, enfolds and condenses cultural parables. The 2013 Feinstein report is an expose of the amygdala, but it is not only that. It engenders a mosaic narrative, a medical pedagogy, patient characters, psychology fashion, and journalism in its very inscription. And in the second part, I want to press that I offer Malcolm McMillan's study of Phineas Gage for another reason, one that brings us back to the scholarship on affect by thinking about the scene or event of affective relationality as fractured and multiply temporal. To McMillan's dismay, much of what is contained in the contemporary textbooks featuring Gage is strikingly at variance with the few extant primary documents. Of the 5 dozen or so books McMillan looks to, he reserves space in several places for an analysis of Antonio Damasio's book, Descartes' Error, Emotion, Reason, and the Human Brain. It ought to be noted at this point that Damasio, until 2005, was professor and head of neurology at the University of Iowa and is co-author in many of the publications on patient SM out of Iowa. McMillan cites Damasio's book as one of several dozen erroneous accounts of Gage that demonstrate, quote, an ignorance of what our primary sources state about the circumstances of the accident. Damasio's narrative of Gage is part of what McMillan describes as the Gage of fable. As Antonio Damasio has it, writes McMillan, Gage virtually became a psychopathic personality who lied and could not be trusted to honor his commitments. Yet Gage's supposed lack of concern for matters he had formerly cared about and his showing little emotion, losing his former values, and becoming unreliable in his personal habits, McMillan writes, almost certainly seep in as characteristics from the brain surgery and psychosurgery literature of the 20th century. A discursive feedback where what was reported and written about in the 1930s and 1960s now become the source material for further narratives in neuroscience. Damasio's retelling of Gage as a, quote, degenerated character with an affective deficit is an ideological commitment made clear in his book's agenda. His message in Gage's case is that observing social convention, behaving ethically, and making decisions advantageous to one's survival and progress require knowledge of rules and strategies and the integrity of specific brain systems. David Bulmer identifies this rhetoric as one that recuperates vitalism in studies of affect. The discourse frames individuals as their neurobiology, the killer, the addict, the deviant, the wounded, through which normalcy is maintained in its difference. Here, parables of lessons learned help neural lesions supplant psychology when ordering humans. Damasio himself explicitly connects the affective deficiencies of patient SM and Phineas Gage in that book, Descartes' Error. He introduces SM not by her pseudonym, but as a woman with a lifelong pattern of personal and social inadequacy, and that she has little concern for the problematic situations into which she gets herself. The folly of her behavior, writes Damasio, is not unlike that found in Phineas Gage and cannot be blamed on poor education or low intelligence. When one takes into consideration the corollary write-ups of patient SM, which describe her as one whose social behavior remains relatively intact, is married, raising children, is able to hold down a job, and is able to carry out a fairly normal social life, Damasio's caricature seems not just more fabulous, but entirely devoted to maintaining a coherent narrative of SM as fitting a pattern where broken brains equal broken affects. Specifically, a broken amygdala translates into a broken or missing fear response. The thicket of stories that both give occasion to patient character like SM and that specifically capture, regulate, and orient patient SM in the literature exposes those layered narrative operations. In the case at hand, normalcy is exposed and affirmed through the abnormal and deficient. The truly fearless are aliens and antagonists attributed to some madness or brain damage. Last year's CO2 study enables and sustains those politics. By way of a serial thriller, through 20 years of publications documenting a history of nerves of steel, what Feinstein and the Iowa team deliver to a hungry public is patient SM's kryptonite. Felicity Callard and Constantina Papoulias are thrilled to point out that the humanities scholars like William Connolly, Andrew Ross, Nigel Thrift, Eric Schuss, and Elizabeth Wilson all cite Antonio Damasio to buttress their own theorizations of affect. The stakes, as they see it, are that the humanities write their stories of affect by quoting the neurosciences. As I demonstrate, however, the trafficking of ideas is a little bit more complex and involves the politics of history as well as a history of political and social anxieties over what it means to feel human. Excavating the exposition published by Feinstein and his colleagues demonstrates that even neuroscience's citationality struggles to account for the arc of its own narrator. Here, what's seen and described as fear in Feinstein's report turns out to be a concept of fear that only arrives by traveling through anatomical expectations, composite character creations, mediated medical recollections, and displaced scientific observations. Thus, my reading of the positioning of affect in that report shows that the neurosciences and the humanities engage narrative to structure the very research agendas and questions pursued. It exposes the powerful work that certain available narrative plots do in various practices of inquiry on their quest for capturing, understanding, and theorizing affects. This entanglement demonstrates how the report implicates an understanding of our contemporary through a history of the present. I underscore the anxieties, or dare I say fears, over how certain accounts of affect participate in culture, as fable, as evidence, as intellectual capital, as characterization, as discipline, and as ideological duties that narratively prompt both theorizations and experimental accounts of affect.
Watching City Channel 4 on TV, online, on demand, on Facebook, and now on the go on your mobile device.